hope you have a good lunch break. I am honored to present our next speaker. She is also, I'm lucky to have her as a teacher and mentor. Leila Mousfi is the chairperson at the American University in Beirut, Department of Architecture and Design. She has been mentoring generations of designers for the past 20 years. I think we owe a lot of the development of Arab visual culture to what she has done in the past 20 years. So please welcome Leila Mousfi.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all, especially the sponsors and the people that are the organizers of this event, and especially Benia, who is my, she calls me her godmother, I call her my godchild. One of the students that passed over the years, I'm very proud of. She's carried the torch and really took it to great heights. So I'm very honored to be here among all of you. And when Bahia first asked me to join, we have a discussion by email how we should do it. And I didn't want to really sit and write things, and I didn't want to show my work. I told her, well, how about an interview? And then she said, there's a text you have once that is very interesting. I said, okay. So I dug it out, reworked it, because it seems it's appropriate according to her. So if you don't like it, blame her. I'm going to read this. I'm going to show you. Everything is very short, by the way. You're not going to get bored. It's fun. The work is fun to see. And then I'm going to show you a little bit of students' work at EV. And then there's going to be some time left where Bahia is going to still stick to the interview part. And then that's OK? Then we can all go home and sleep. Anyway. So, everyone in this room knows how powerful graphic design is. That it's not just a clever juxtaposition of words and images. That it's not just a way to get people to pay attention to whatever it is you want them to pay attention to. It's not just something pretty or intriguing, inviting or disturbing. All of you know that graphic design is something magical, and that it's richly connected with the culture from which it emanates. The people to whom it reaches out, with beauty and the sublime, with psychology and philosophy. All of you know that graphic design truly matters, and that the designer is a person who gives form and expression to the culture he or she lives in, thus becoming a creator and interpreter of the lived environment. Yes, that's what we are, and that's what we do. We work with images and words, with symbols and signs. We're semioticians as much as we may be painters or sculptors. We're cognitive scientists as much as we may be craftspeople. All you have to do is look at the origins of the so-called Arab Spring to understand who we are and what we do and how we fit into the world of the early 21st century, how we have shaped that world. The revolutions that toppled rulers weren't inspired by men shouting at the masses from soap boxes. No, it was the images posted on Facebook that precipitated those movements. It wasn't plainly eloquent speeches that drove the disenfranchised into the streets, but terse 140 character Twitter statements. Often crude images, often awkwardly phrased statements. But it was we, graphic designers, who led the way. We who trained those who called the people into the streets, using only the power of the shower, unorthodox images, and brusque, incisive words. We showed them how to create words and images, to give form and expression to their culture, and to use these words and images to interpret and alter their environments. Sadly, of course, most of these valiant beginnings have run off course, but whatever has come of them, we cannot deny that the world we live in now has been, in part, shaped by what we have learned, have done, and have taught others to do. For me, my experience started in the early 80s, the first time. But the real experience goes back over 20 years, actually to October 1992, when the American University of Beirut launched the region's first four-year graphic design program. What a mix it was. The program was offered by the Department of Architecture and Design and housed with the faculty, within the Faculty of Engineering and Architecture. There weren't many of us back then, just one full-timer, myself, and a few part-timers, out of which Samir Slade, sitting right there, my dear friend and creator of that program with me. Now there are 6 full-time faculty members and 12 part-timers, out of which some are faculty. And we have sent more than 500 of our graduates into the world. Some of you are in this room. Some of you have hired our graduates. You've come across their work in just about every field that's in any way related to graphic design, from type design to comic books, to publications, to advertising, to web design, and to jewelry making, among others. You name it, EB graduates have done it and usually done it well. Our graduates, like other graduates, have had a huge impact on the world we work in. In the late 80s and early 90s, graphic design was practically non-existent in Lebanon and in the East. Before the inauguration of EUB's program, it was advertising agencies that set the standard in the field, defined the parameters of the work, and determined the extent to which graphic design would rise to aesthetics, social and political rights. That has all changed, as post-war Lebanon opened opportunities for the country's participation in global markets, designers had to acquire solid training in the theoretical, practical, and technical aspects of the discipline. They had to be prepared for professional careers that could accommodate the needs and requirements of Lebanon and the region. They had to become graphic designers, not just people who knew how to lay out and track the composition or to edit copy well. At EUB, we've had, as in everyone, our share of challenges and of sometimes wrenching changes as our program and the field in general has grown, perhaps matured is the best word. We don't teach the way we taught in the beginning, having become increasingly student-oriented and increasingly willing to take risks and to insist that our students take risks and assert themselves. We've taught our students how to critique their work and then to critique their critique. We've taught them to conceptualize what they want to do, to plan and to replan, to theorize and strategize, to debate, to be willing, to be wrong, to be willing to tell other people that they think those people are wrong and why, and what they should do to remedy the problems. And we have taught them to do all these things without losing sight of important things, things like beauty, like heart, like depth of emotion. Our program was and remains firmly committed to the principle that design is part of an environment, which in turn is part of a culture. This culture can exist in history, heritage, tradition, values, language, and many additional aspects that form the fabric of a society. And it's up to each student to search for his or her voice, the voice that will enable each of them to contribute to and even alter the design standards that they're working within. Some of the changes we have undergone have evolved organically from within the program and the discipline. Some, of course, have been imposed from without, as, for example, the many technological innovations of the past several decades that have turned sketchers and layout folks into computer geeks. Through it all, whatever artistic techniques we teach and whatever medium of production we work in, our focus has to remain on teaching people how to think about, construct, and communicate a message. The work of the graphic design program at EUB is also influenced by a second important factor, the multicultural and multilingual realities of the Arab world. So our program, combining the cultural realities we live amid with the technological revolutions that appear at an ever-increasing pace, has engaged in revolutionary explorations of ways to connect new thinking about graphic typography with the possibilities offered by computers. This pushes our students and faculty to undertake cutting-edge studies of traditional design rules and then to integrate these new findings into software and thereby into design itself. Add to this the worldwide trend towards universal language, and you have an area of research and aesthetics that is under continuum, always exciting, often stressful, pressure to change, to rethink itself, to adapt to a world that seems to redefine itself by the minute. It's been like this from the beginning. Digital and time-based media were introduced as core courses in the program as early as 1995, allowing us to address and integrate advancements in technology and changing market needs into our curriculum and into the way we taught. Such an approach enabled our graduates to seek job opportunities in film, TV, and interactive media companies, as well as critically think of technology as a tool and medium. Our program's aim is to educate a new generation of designers and to prepare them to heal social rifts by developing an international language that is able to address the needs of a multicultural community. Designers and architects are the new creators of society's culture. In addition to adapting to social changes and demands, a designer must also develop an intellectual framework that will enable him or her to offer ideas and solutions to a wide range of design problems. Learning the elements of a new discipline and applying analytical thinking to achieve positive results always presents a challenge. Things continue to change. In the early years of the program, for example, students were interested in the craftsmanship of design and the subject of design as a whole. The topics chosen for final year research projects were more focused on the aesthetics and typography of communication and the arts in general. Today, our students' interest seems to have shifted. It is said that a generation skips after the war. Today's EUB students are often intrigued by the aftermath of the Civil War, the Lebanese Civil War, a war that none of our current students lived through. Students are investigating the individual and collective memories of this war, trying to understand it, trying to understand what it meant to those who lived through it, and of course what it means for the Lebanon they live in now. We're teaching more women as well. Our initial ratio was 30% to 40% men, while today the student body is predominantly female, as is the case within the architecture program, so it's not just design. Today's students are serious, passionate, and conceptual. Most are privileged, coming to us from private schools. 90% of our students are Lebanese, who are all dual citizenships. A few come from neighboring countries, mainly Syria now. Our interdisciplinary department offers two undergraduate programs and degrees, one in architecture and one in graphic design. The first semester, design is a common design course between architecture and design. Many of our projects reach out to the community, and some faculty members initiate projects with medicine, agriculture, and many of the centers of the university. Students are encouraged to participate in competitions or campaigns, which are sometimes worked into a given studio class. Finally, students are exposed to international designers and scholars who are invited to lecture and offer workshops through a lecture series program for both architecture and design. We've come a long way. AUB's graphic design program has thrived, growing and adapting to the realities the outside world brings us, as well as the realities that we, graphic design students and faculty, bring to the equation. And we've all come a long way, haven't we? 20 years ago, there was one grant in the graphic design program in the Middle East, and today, look how many there are. Mainly today, we know that graphic design is alive and well engaged. Okay, so I'll show you a little bit of students' work. Some that are older, and some you won't see well. So the designer is one who gives form and expression to the culture he or she lives in, thus becoming a creator and interpreter of the lived environment. Various projects across the years. So, Kara, for you. You remember that? Where's Kara? Carla Sanden, sitting right there. A project that she did in 1997 or 1998. And the calligraphy is Samir Sayed that we will see. It was a publication project then. So, in my opinion, this is a project that still lives through. It has trespassed, surpassed all ages. It's over 16 years old, and it's still as beautiful as it was 16 years ago. So, anyway, that's your surprise. Sounds. Now, most of the projects I chose to show were a mixture of the Latin and Arabic, which is what we pushed a lot at EUB. I mean, the presence of Samir Sayed teaching our students to Arabic calligraphy and typography, how it would be implemented, and the Latin typography that I gave, and a mixture of the two. That's something more recent. For those who know Reza Alimidin's work, it's very influenced by his work. It's one of our graduates' work, a publication also. If I'm going too fast, let me know. I guess not. Okay, these I just threw them in because I think they're fun. There is a class we give which is packaging and installation. And one of the very creative projects we give where they think really outside of the box is to take an artist or a writer or a poet and create a shoot for that person out of what that interpretation. So this is Naji Ali, for those of you who knows who Naji Ali is. How many of you there, other than many of you? Okay, Naji Ali was an illustrator, right? Palestinian illustrator. He was known for his comic strip or his illustration, where he always had a character that was backwards. He always saw the character from the back. So this shoe has no front, it's two bucks. Sewn together with a barbed wire, portraying Naji Ali. This is Hitchcock. So it's not a shoe, it's a shadow of a shoe. Okay? This is Jennifer Lopez. Extreme nudity. Okay. This is Eddie Murphy. Okay. Enough for the fun. This is one of the final year projects. A student graduated this last year, and he did a book on madness. He is Italian, and he decided that there were characters he met in his life that were mad, like mad as in mad, really. And he dedicated the whole book, and he investigated madness and all of this. So this is the book he came up with, which was almost like, it was a huge book, but exquisitely done, where he created for each character these collages. So you see that there's a strong interest in typography and Arabic type calligraphy slash whatever we would call it. Because I still have a problem given it a name. Melissa also in 2013, she decomposed Plato's book, and it was also playing around and experimenting with type. And it's just taking type to another level where it becomes piece of art or something that is enjoyable to look at, really taking out the meaning from it. Such experimentation can bring you back to doing something more traditional but with a touch of something at the end. Mary Schweitzer graduated in 2006. She did she created all this Samir Hotel. She did create a fund, Sheikh Yamir Hotel. Because Samir was advising her on the. No? Yeah, how did she come to her? It was, her book was about the history of Lebanon. Which history do we follow? Because in Lebanon, nobody agrees on the history after the French mandate. So there are different versions. And what she did, she created these two characters, a rooster and a turkey, that go across history and they tell you the story of the Lebanese history. Okay. This was last year. She did like a guidebook with a mixture of photography and illustration. Nadia Khalili took three poems of Abu Nawas and she decomposed also. She doesn't speak a word of Arabic, by the way. So, for all of my reasons, it was more about the form rather than the meaning and the content. This is the second one. It was three books. Newspaper for the art and the culture. This was last year. And the last project, Sarah Abdullah, that's revisiting the war. It's about her mom and her aunt, that how they eliminated each other from the photos. All a photographic journey, which was sort of a mixture of type and image, but beautifully wrong in a sense. Okay, there we go. So, I'm done.
Navigating communities and typography. How do you see the future of Arabic typography? What do you think needs to be done? And do you have any solutions in mind? So I just want your views on that.
I don't have solutions because I'm not an Arabic. I'm not an Arabic typographer. And I still feel uncomfortable using the word Arabic typography as such because it's a Latin term. And I believe that the problematics that we always laid out. Samir and I were that the Arabic was forced onto a Latin machine. And somebody did talk about it. Who was it? But anyway, so the problematic is there. As a matter of fact, I believe my friend Reza, he made one statement that I always in the back of my mind. And he said, if Gutenberg was an Arab, okay, what would happen to Latin like today? Okay, so they would have the same problem. So I mean, so the machine was really, or whatever was created for Latin. And here we are trying to squeeze all our givens. So I think it's about developing technology, which Thomas Nilo is doing well, and others. And I think it's about embracing the culture. It's about understanding. And what Samir, I think, did with the students was to make them respect their culture, respect knowing. How can you do something new if you don't understand the world? Okay? That was always the statement. We always had this. But you see, the time we started doing all
try something else. And I feel that my asking about advice, I think it's too early to put labels on this is type, this is that, etc. It's too early yet. And I think if typographers or people that have love for literature, if they can go following their intuitions and be more spontaneous and passionate, and then things, I mean, a machine can be inventive. I mean, here, no design furniture. They would invent a machine to do some, you know, screws for a design just to do that design. So, I mean, why not? Why not create a machine that would do everything? To handle what's on the market, you know? I mean, so I think it's more about respecting what we have. And going back to our roots, which is very important. And again, we talk about universal language. I don't like the word universal. I prefer using international, because international has the word national, which is nationality, which is not losing your identity, who you are, you see? So I mean, there's a difference. Universal, you're part of the universe, and you could be from Mars, as far as I'm concerned.
So, thank you, Leila.
Okay.